A cowrie shell is buried at the foot of a baobab tree, an offering to the spirit of the tree, for it's about to be robbed of one of its branches. The blacksmith has been commissioned to carve a mask. With him has come the head of the Mask Society, the master of masks. The swollen branches of the baobab contain a lot of wood, and another smith from a neighbouring hamlet is also in need of some. Climbing a baobab can be a painful business, for its trunk is studded with ferocious spines. People are not free to wear masks just as they like. They may only be owned by members of the Awa, and the right to a particular kind of mask can only be given by the master of masks. He is responsible for ensuring that protocol is strictly observed, that no one wears a mask to which he's not entitled. Nor may anyone make any mask. Most masks and images can be made only by the blacksmith. Only he has the skill or the prerogative. So after a man has been given the master's permission to wear a mask, he must commission the smith to make it. The visiting blacksmith is not making a mask, but a statue. Its shape is already clear in his mind's eye, lying inside the wood, and he can mark it out roughly so that unnecessary and heavy wood can be cut away before carrying the log back to the village. The master of masks supervises all stages. The work must be done in secret, for no woman or child may see a mask or a statue until it's brought out at the proper time. So the work is done not in the village itself, but among the rocks just outside. Only a few yards away, women are passing on their way to the village. They know perfectly well what is going on, but no one would dream of being so rude or so shameless as to sneak a look. The master of masks speaks French. This country was once French territory. And through him, I asked the smith what he was carving. An old woman has died, he said, and I'm making a statue of her for her funeral celebrations. A statue that will be carried on the head of the chief mourner as he dances. Why has she got such a thin body? Because she was an old woman, he said. But if she was an old woman, then why does she have such young breasts? To show that once she was a real woman, and because her family would like to remember her as she was in her prime.
Oh, about a moment.
The other smith was carving a mask, a monkey mask, the master said. Was this the first time he had made a monkey mask? No, he had made three before. How did he know what a monkey mask should look like? Was it going to be his own personal invention? An old blacksmith had once shown him one and told him how to do it. Apart from the ones he had made himself, had he seen any others? No, only that first one. The mask must be pierced with holes to take a lattice of rope which will hold it on the dancer's head. The actual threading of the rope is never done by the smith. That is the responsibility of another official of the Mask Society. It's good. All that remains to be done is to paint it black with a special vegetable sap. Some people say that art these days in Africa is dead. And yet it does seem to me that this mask, in its simple strength and purity of line, has much of the quality that many of the older pieces that are the treasured possessions in our Western museums have. And yet I know, to my certain knowledge, that it was only cut from a baobab tree some 3 days ago. But of course, art with a capital A has very little meaning for the Dogon. They have no such word for it in their language. For them, a mask like this, sculpture, is not something to hang on the wall or put on an occasional table. For them, it is something which has to be seen in a proper context, on someone's shoulders, surrounded by a costume, in motion, accompanied by the throb of drums. Only then does it cease to be a mere piece of hewn wood and become a powerful symbol that the whole community understands. And until that moment comes, a mask like this will be put in a sack and stuffed in some corner in a dusty hut, unregarded.
Yalu